Giovanni, ma che è? No, non posso mangiare. E la spinterò a giochino marcia.
Well, not since the dawn of motoring has this sound been heard near the fabled rock of Gibraltar. An enlightened governor, Sir Reginald Buller Cowley, initiated the first Grand Prix du Rock in 1906. But perhaps his enthusiasm overrode his sense of the practical, since in the very first lap, D'Ambrosio on the 750 horsepower 22.1 liter three-cylinder Bolzano, hot favorite in the voiturette class, missed the corner near the Methodist chapel and motored gently into the water. He was soon joined by some of the competitors in the larger cars, Walter Freeston, later Lord Gunnett, on the Doubleday Squires, Capolavoro on the 73-liter La Merveilleuse, von Schlitzenberg to Braunhof on the little 42-liter Valhalla, Prince Pazzo dell'Asilo on the quaint SAAECVB, standing for Société Anonyme des Anciens Établissements des Constructeurs de Voitures en Bois, with its revolutionary wooden engine, and the Duke of Hesse plus Hesse driving as a passenger with his chauffeur at the wheel, and a masked lady by his side in the 100-liter Pomeraner. The only other competitor left in the race, Roger Knut, was disqualified for soliciting aid in pushing his 1,000-horsepower Navajo mobile, built incidentally in Tucson, after his engine stalled as he swerved to avoid a monkey which had strayed from the rock to watch the race. There was no outright winner on this occasion, and the harbor could not be used for shipping until the autumn of 1909. Students of history will know that British foreign policy inclined to be conciliatory during the period in which the hulks of racing cars blocked the harbor, but that with the raising of the Pomeraner, which later became the sloop HMS Incorrigible, the British got tough again. Now, over half a century later, another enlightened governor, Lord Weeps of Sebring, has dared to reconstitute this grand epreuve, and a romantic setting it is indeed for a race. The rock itself, gaunt sentinel guarding the secrets of bygone ages, stands a silent and reluctant witness to the animated scene below. Where Moor and Christian once crossed swords, now a more civilized battle is waged, and the warm southern air is filled with the fragrance of dates wafted across from the Afric shore, mingling subtly with the no less fragrant odors of rosemary, wild thyme, lavender, and gasoline. The course is a tortuous one, beginning with an initial straight of 8 yards near the starting grid, leading to the gasworks chicane, into the stockpile tunnel, out into the 1.5-1 gradient up to Methodist Chapel corner, down the cliff face onto the beach known as the Devil's Sand Pit, from there, briefly into the water, a swift straight to the Spanish frontier, a sharp left turn at Customs Shed Carousel, into the S's, which are really more like R's in shape, onto the mud and pave of the marshalling yards, and into that fast 8 yards near the starting grid again. There are, of course, 94 laps. Now, here by my side is Roland Thaxter of the BBC, the British Broadcasting Corporation. I hope I've got that right, Roland.
Yes. Yes, that's absolutely right.
He is the ace commentator in Britain, and he will describe the scene as he sees it.
Well, of course, Jib, as we know it, is well known to us. And very colorful sight it is today, even for one who during the war, as I did, knew it perfectly well. The colors are brighter than usual. There are the reds of the French, as it were, the reds of the, well, I've got my notes here, the reds of Italian, yes, that's, the reds of the Italian cars contrasting vividly, I think, is the right word, with the blues of the French cars and the white and green of the other nations. Also, there is, of course, the 17th Battalion of the Royal Rutlandshire Fusiliers, who are stationed here, and a very fine regiment they are, who are at the moment beginning their march past to herald the arrival of the Duke of Edinburgh, who has is going to open the course on his detuned Morris, which, and a very attractive little car it is too. It may take some time, owing to the fact that the regimental mascot which is taking part in the parade is a tortoise, and of course, as a consequence, the parade has to move at the pace of the regimental pet. Now, that is statutory, and there's nothing we can do about it. I just hope that the tortoise will realize that we're all waiting.
Well, thank you very much, Roland. We'll hear from you later, and I don't think I could have put it as concisely as you did, but of course, you have... Yeah, I've never been here before, but...
Oh, I know it frightfully well, and one misses the rock when one isn't on it. In London, I miss the rock a great deal. Yes, well, if anything I can do later on to explain to you the colours of the cars or any technical knowledge which you may not have, I will be more than... mind my tea, it's right on the edge of the table. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't say that. Well, I will do my very best to help.
Now, before the race starts, we will take you into the pits so we can actually talk to some of these men that are going to drive round the rock today. And first of all, the German pit, where the 1.5-liter Schnorshades is still under dust sheets. And here is the young German aristocrat, Graf Wolfram von Grips, great friend of us all. And would you care to say a few words, Wolfram?
Yeah, well, I don't know how much I'm allowed to say. Of course, we work in the greatest secrecy here. And, well, I notice you're walking on crutches. Does that indicate... Well, no, I haven't been hurt or anything. It's just that the position in the car that we have to adopt owing to the very special construction of this car is extremely difficult to get used to. I have to... was sagen Sie eigentlich da? Perhaps you'd care to meet Herr Altbauer, who is the chief of our racing group, and...
Ja, Sie müssen doch gar nicht sagen. Es ist unerhört, dass Sie das sagen.
Yeah, but he will tell you. I'm afraid I'm... I'm not really... We are working, as I say, in the greatest...
But you want to know. Well, is the... The fact that Herr von Grips is on crutches?
No, that's because we have a new construction of the car. We believe that the car is the main thing to consider, and that man must be a slave of his machine. Now, the position we adopt in the car, owing to problems of weight balance and other problems too technical to go into here, means that the man must... sit on the floor, but with one leg forward and the other backward. Naturally, this needs a little draining.
I see, but,
von Grips?
Yeah?
It's time to blow your nose now.
Ah, now already?
Please, don't argue.
Well, what was that?
We have discovered after our laboratory investigations that the best time to blow the nose, to have it completely clear, is 7.5 minutes before the race begins. This is important because a handkerchief carried in the pocket would be extra weight. As we have no central pockets on our overalls, it means that a handkerchief would have to be either in the left pocket or in the right pocket, which would completely destroy the balance of this revolutionary new car which we have adopted.
Yes. Do you have any other elements? Which other people do not have? Are you studying anything new?
Well, of course, we have a great interest here in the German, in the Schnorshades works, in the psychologisch conditioning of the drivers. Consequently, we have the music of Wagner, which is played continuously, like Muzak, in our pits. The pieces of music selected according by a psychologist, wie sagt man das eigentlich in Englisch? Ich weiß nicht. By a psychiatrist
who has made a long study of this, so that during tire changes we have some of the faster music during moments of difficulty where the driver perhaps needs soothing because something is not working. We have the Venus belt music, which we can tell all this from the relative dilation of the pupils of the eyes of people. And we have made a great study of this.
I see. Well, that's very interesting. Now, who are the competitors that you fear most as rivals?
We fear no one. We are slightly worried by the Italians, by the British, and by the French. Apart from this, we are completely confident that with the amount of preparations we have made, nobody else has made these preparations. And thank you very much. I would ask you not to ask any more questions. There will be a formal press release after our victory.
Thank you very much. And I see the cars are covered with dust sheets. They're evidently very secret, and Herr Altbauer has now left. He's a stickler for discipline. There are four cars there. One is slightly out of line. They must be very light because Herr Altbauer has just picked one up in order to put it back in line with the others, and that's the only hint we have of the lightness of the German cars. And seeing the ease with which he picked it up, I can quite imagine that a handkerchief might make all the difference.
Vous voyez pas qu'est-ce que vous faites là-bas? Vous tournez tous en bas, les enfants.
Well, now we're over in the French pit, the Orgini pit, and Monsieur Orgini is here himself. He's evoked the admiration of the entire racing fraternity by his very gallant struggle against lack of funds. I don't think I'm speaking out of turn there.
No, it's nothing I seek to disguise. Would you care for a cigarette?
What? You smoke in the pits here?
Oh, yes, it's all right. The cars are insured. Light? Well, we had no time to finish the cars owing to the strike in France. Actually, we had no time to finish the cars because of the lack of money, but the strike gives us a good excuse for not having finished the cars.
Well, I noticed that one car is blue and the other is just a kind of metal color.
Well, you know, paint costs money, and I hope the Germans will forgive us because we haven't had time, and the French government tax on paint is extremely because it's being dominated by the painters, of course. The Bernard Buffet, the other French painters, are taking all the paint.
Well, is there anything very new in your engines? This year?
No, the engines are the same as we've always had. They are very old. If you can find us a new engine before the race starts, we will be extremely grateful. We are extremely practical people. And after all, it's le sport. Sport.
Well, you have no hope of winning, then?
We always have hope of winning because the others might lose. That is a philosophy which has colored all our attitude since we started this.
But what are those bottles I notice there? I see a lot of bottles. Is that cognac? Is that brandy?
Yes, of course, racing fuels are not allowed, but, you know, French machinery is emotional, like French people, and it seems to understand what is desired of it, and therefore, sometimes a little Armagnac, a little cognac in the carburetor, well, it goes better.
Well, there's a lot of girls around here, and very beautiful girls. I don't think I've ever seen so many beautiful girls in any pit in my life. What are they doing here?
Well, you know, they are friends of the drivers, and we find girls useful because our pit is next to the Germans, and it may make the Germans a little less efficient because with their Wagner music and all that, it annoys Monsieur Altbauer to have the girls here. And
you really feel that you will not win this race?
Well, if we lose, we still get the starting money, you know. It's too late to take that from us, and perhaps in the next race we will have both cars painted. And if during the race you feel like a smoke, you can always come in here, you know.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Argini. Well, now we're in the Italian pit, the Fanfani car. We're which is here, and a really exclusive interview we have here with the great Paraguayan champion.
Ow, Maguera, I don't know where to fly.
Jose Julio Fandango, who is very, very shy, never likes to give interviews, and we also have here...
Giovanni. Ow.
Higinio Rosa Ruby, who will translate for us. He is, of course, the very talented amateur driver, and could you translate for us, Mr. Rosa Ruby?
I would be very pleased to do so. You want to talk to Mr. Fandango, who is here, and anything you want to ask him, I will do my best to translate to him, and...
Just one question. Does he think he'll win?
Does he think he'll win? ¿Usted cree que me quería ver atrás?
No, que fuera de la vera, una de la cuadra, una de la cuadra, guadañita, fuera de la cuadra.
Ma igual, el mundo que lleva, vendrá aquí a la vera de cuadra, guadañara, el curso, 40, que me llega, vendrá y me trae.
No, monedera, no voy a creer, monedera, llevar a la cuadra, monedera, está muy cara.
Ma que lleva, y el vaya, no, monedera, todo bien, que lleva.
Could we have an answer now?
He says he doesn't know whether he's going to win or not.
Well, that is a very exclusive interview. I don't think that Mr. Fandango has ever been interviewed before, and thank you both very much.
Sí, señor.
Thank you very much.
And now... here is Commendatore Fanfani, a very distinguished constructor of racing automobiles. He's coming over here. Senor Fanfani?
Yeah.
Now, I want one question. I want to...
Mannaggia la morte, non funziona niente. Ma che varela! Mette la moto due motori in combina con l'altra, ma non posso, ma io non niente. Mannaggia la morte, ma costre, ma la mamma che va. Ma che la donna va da questa all'accensione del due piccolo motori di carburatore. Ma che?
Well, perhaps this is not the moment, and we'll try and come back later before the race actually. And here we are in the British pits, and here is Gerling Foss. Gerling, you're a part-time optometrist, aren't you? No, that's my friend. Tony Cooks, as a matter of fact. He's got an appointment in London tomorrow, a consultation, and consequently he hopes very much that the race will be over by then, but personally I doubt it. You doubt whether the race will be over tomorrow? Well, it's a, quite frankly, it's a bloody awful track, isn't it? I mean, there's no room to overtake. Whoever starts first will be an enormous advantage, because nobody can overtake him except in the water. Now, the water's going to play a cardinal part in this, as I reckon, and I'm wearing overshoes myself because I hate wet feet. Why, you do you think the Germans, as everyone else thinks, are going to win this race? No. Well, they stand a very good chance, of course, but they're over-organized in that hurdling position they have to adopt. I mean, they've, you know, they they're a funny people, aren't they? They forget, you know, that. When hurdling, a hurdler isn't in that position all the time. He's got to run as well between the hurdles, you see. They do things so perfectly, they forget some of the elementary things. And I don't know, speaking personally, if I was in that position, my reflexes wouldn't be at all what they should be. Just a moment, Tom, let me get out to... you've said on previous occasions, I remember talking to you at Sebring, that brakes are very important. Well, don't quote me on this, but I think the engine's important, and the chassis, and the driver. I think those are the four cardinal things: brakes, chassis, engine, driver, and those are the things to watch. Those are the things, quite frankly, to watch. Well, apart from that, who do you think has a chance here, Gerling? Well, quite frankly, and again, don't quote me on this. There's a sport. I think none of us have got much of a chance. And that's. I'd like to leave it at that for the moment. Thank you very much. And here we are in the pit of the wildfowl, which is made, of course, by the Oklahoma City enthusiast Riggs Willingham. And here is the driver, Bill Dill. Bill, I haven't seen you for a long time, not since, was it Sebring or...
Yes. Now, here at the wildfowl we have here.
Well, it certainly looks a very pretty car, if a little heavy, perhaps.
Well, it's got a souped-up checker engine with four L-heads.
Four L-heads. Oh, that should give quite a bit of power.
Yes. Well, of course, we're here to learn. We're not here to win. We're here to learn. The power steering, for instance, makes it practically impossible to turn at less than 90 degrees. That presents its own special problems. And we've lightened it as much as possible.
Well, it looks a little heavy. It looks very pretty and very beautiful.
Well, it's really a prototype of a new dream car called the Cabana Club. And we've lightened it as much as possible, as I was saying, by taking out the ashtrays and substituting a smaller dash clock. And if there's time, and I don't know if there is, they're working on it right now, we're going to ditch the armrests.
What are those? The outside exhausts? I haven't seen those for many years, not since the great vintage days.
Oh, they're dummies.
Uh-huh. Well, are there any other problems you have here?
Well, of course, I've been driving European cars mainly, and my hand keeps reaching for the shift, and of course there's none there, because this has the Magic Touch Lubramatic transmission. I think it's a great transmission, but I don't think it's ideal for this course.
There's a lot of chrome on the car.
Yes, the weight of the chrome alone is more than the entire Schnorshades. Well, one thing I will say, it's comfortable, yes. And we're carrying four suitcases to keep the back wheels on the road.
Well, that's so much for the wildfowl. Now, here's an interesting and a rare phenomenon. There is a Russian observer here from the All-Union Center of Sport and... What is it, Mr. Volikov?
All-Union Center of Sports and Machinery.
All-Union Center of Sports and Machinery. Now, Mr. Semyon Volikov, I hope I've got that right.
Yeah, thank you very much.
You're watching this race?
Yes, I have been sent to watch the race.
And I see you've got a camera slung around you. You're going to take photographs of it?
That's the intention.
Is Russia going to produce a racing car soon?
I can't say. I'm not allowed to say.
But that must be the reason why you're here.
I'm afraid I am not in a position to make any declaration at the moment.
But could there be any other reason you're here?
I'm afraid my lips must necessarily, for the moment, be sealed. But we have some surprises for you, which will be seen in due course.
But I've noticed watching you, Mr. Volikov, that with that camera of yours, you're taking pictures mainly of the rock and not of the racing cars.
I am the observer, not you.
Well, now, as the hour that the race is due to start approaches, I think we'll take you into the shed where the chief steward, Mr. John Buttress, is briefing the drivers at the drivers' meeting.
Good afternoon to you all. Welcome to Gibraltar. I hope we'll have a very good race. We hope to win, of course. If we don't, we won't feel sorry, because I think we'll have a very good and very mixed meeting. We've welcomed a lot of very distinguished foreign drivers here today. Now, there's very little I want to say. The Duke of Edinburgh, His Royal Highness, who should have opened the race, I don't know whether he can arrive here in time, but if he arrives during the race, of course the race will stop until he has taken his place in his box. Now, that's a little courtesy we like to extend, and we ask you to bear with us there, and stop your cars and rise in the driver's seat. And at the signal, you can proceed with the race. Now, apart from that, there's very little I want to say, unless there are any questions. No passing on the cliff face. I mean, that's fairly obvious. Just a little note directed to the French contingent that I've watched during practice. Monsieur, no smoking while passing the gas works chicane. Now, I'm afraid that is a rule
By the Gibraltar Gas Board.
Oh, là là, on peut pas fumer maintenant, c'est dangereux.
Yes, I know it's hard on you because you rely upon it.
Oh, là là.
Now, are there any questions? Yes, Herr von Grips, I see your hand is up.
Please, if the Duke of Edinburgh should arrive, and while we are standing, the engines stall. I mean, that's hardly part of the race, and I think we ought to be able to have help there if the engines stall under those conditions.
Well, we thought that, and luckily, there are a whole contingent of the 19th Gibraltar Boy Scout, the ROC contingent, which are ready to help you. All you have to do is to raise two fingers of your right hand in the scout salute, and they will come running to your assistance.
Oh, thank you very much.
Oh, Mr. Altbauer, you don't seem satisfied with that.
No, I mean, it's ridiculous, owing to the driving position of our cars, which has now leaked to the press, I don't know how, because the place is full of snooping. The driving position, as known, is with the legs at 180 degrees to each other to make the balance of the car perfect, so that one leg is forward and the other backward from the driver. Now, like this, it's very difficult for him to stand up. I don't understand what we can do, because they will need help to stand up, and for the first half hour they can't stand anyway after they've been in this position for some time if the Duke of Edinburgh should arrive near the end of the race.
Well, of course, it's not obligatory to stand up. It's just polite, you know, Dr. Altbauer. And we don't insist on your driver standing up. All that will inevitably happen is, of course, that you will lose the sympathy of the crowd, and I think you have to put up with that.
I don't know. Everything is always arranged to make us unpopular. I don't understand.
Well, I'm terribly sorry about that. Now, Mr. Fandango, you have a question? Would you help him, Mr. Rezarubi?
Yeah, una question.
Now, hola, guardia, me quedaré cuesta con un bendí de la cuarta de cero.
Me quedaré, yo me lo quedaré, me 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 quedaré.
Have we got that question yet?
Yeah, he wants to. It's not a question, just ask. The window could be open a little. There's no air in here.
Oh, yes, certainly. Galling Foss, you have a question?
Yes, what flags are being used here? I mean, I've seen so many during practice, it's slightly bewildering. I mean, I'm willing to abide by any rules, but I've seen too many flags to be quite sure what they all mean.
That's a very good question, Gerling. I want you all to listen very carefully to this. All the usual flags will be used with the following additions. Union Jack oscillated in a clockwise direction means that the Duke has arrived. Stop your cars, get out, and stand reverently at attention for a moment until the Union Jack is waved in an anti-clockwise direction, in which case you will resume your driving seat and continue in your own time. Now, a pale blue and orange flag, make a note of that if you will, pale blue and orange, that means enemy air attack. In case that happens, and on the rock you're never sure, it's a very obvious target should the balloon go up. All cars will go into the tunnel until the all clear, when the race will continue. And there's a pink flag. A pink flag raised and held statically aloft. That means that there have been complaints from the resident of the Rock Hotel. Please motor as quietly as possible. Now, are there any more questions to that? May the best man win. Thank you very much. No more questions? Well, good luck to you all.
And now the race should start any moment. And here is the governor of Gibraltar is rising slowly to the podium. He's being helped by several Boy Scouts. He's a very venerable gentleman that we all admire and cherish, Lord Weeps of Sebring. And maybe, as this is a great British character, Raymond Thaxter, would you say a few words about his background while he's negotiating those last two steps, please?
Yes, certainly. Well, Lord Weeps is a is a really fine old sportsman. He's been in politics since 1883, and a very wonderful career he's had. Minister of Pensions in 1896. He won the decathlon for Great Britain in the first Olympic Games. He has been a fencing champion. He's been in the show jumping team before the turn of the century. Cricket, football, lawn tennis, the Gordon Bennett Trophy. He's a really wonderful old sportsman and a wonderful old sport. And I think he's going to say a few words now to the crowd, and he will, of course, start the race.
This is the second Grand, whatever it is, I can't read this paper, the Duroc. I want you to abide by the rules, to come out fighting, no hitting below the, as you were. I want you to keep a straight bat and abide by the whistle. Don't balk any other horse. Run a good, clean race. No foot faulting. Chin up. Don't shoot till you see the white. Anyway, I've carry on the old tradition. Make this a land fit for heroes. Leave the door open for negotiation. Well, we don't want to fight, but by jingo, there'll always be an England. Carry on.
Well, there's an atmosphere of great tension here. I can only describe the atmosphere as extremely tense, as the drivers begin one by one to crouch in the circles which have been marked for that purpose on the road, with the exception of the Germans, that is, who are being carried into position by their mechanics now. There's Fling, there's von Grips. The governor is facing the sea, but an equerry has just turned him to face the track. And yes, his arm is being lifted for him. The checkered flag is up. I can't describe the tension here. Twenty seconds. Well, perhaps you'd care to hear my stopwatch. Just to let you know that you're in good hands. I say, I didn't mean that.
Really. 1, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
They're off. Governor, drop the flag. That is, the governor dropped, and he carried the flag down with him. Well, anyway, whatever the reason for that, they're off. Gerling Foss, the first to go. There's young Cooks. Hello, hello, Fandango's in trouble.
It sounds like you've got a flat battery. Well, that is a revolutionary start to this race. The favorite, no, he's shaking his head, and he's getting out of his car, and he's... Yes, he's given up.
And the governor's up. They've picked the governor up, and he's holding the flag up again. I don't know what...
Although it's too late, really, for that. I mean, they're...
Yes. Well, I think they're telling him that the race has started. I don't know. Yeah, so I didn't get that, but I'm sure that if we perhaps sent a runner over, we'd get the news that imparted. I think I can hear a noise. Isn't that a glint? I can't see the number yet, but here they come. Yes, Foss, Cooks, John Amal, Borkhorn. No sign of the French or genies. Did you see anything in that blue there at all, in that mass of vivid colour?
No, I don't know. Well, there was certainly no Orgini there.
Well, the race is well and truly joined. The governor's just dropped his flag again.
Well, that's very interesting. I wonder where they're going to start timing it from.
Oh, surely from when the car started.
Well, I don't know, you know. He is the governor, after all.
Now, we've had 5 laps of this race, and the position at the moment... Just a moment.
Do I see it? Yes, I do. The Union Jacks are oscillating. The Duke has arrived in his little Morris, beautifully painted in 3 shades of royal mauve. He's coming down the track now. All right, this is exciting. There won't be time to signal all the cars to stop, I'm afraid, now. Yes. Duke's great sportsman, elbowing the chauffeur out of the way. He's taken over with that infectious, high, good humor so characteristic of him. He's taken Bill Dill. Yes, he's passed Girling Foss, I say. Can he overtake Fandango before the tunnel? No. 3 cars are now all in the tunnel. Von Grips, Fandango, and the Duke. As it's pitch black in the tunnel, overtaking is well nigh impossible. But waiting impatient. Hello! The Duke's out first and into the water, where the sailors of the fishery protection vessel Perkin Warbeck are giving him a rousing cheer. He's temporarily out of sight now, and...
Well, the German cars have stopped.
Yes, they've stopped, and the drivers, unable to rise, are holding their right arms in the air. This may be the best they can do, but I think it's hardly the most tactful solution to their problem, put it that way.
Well, Foss has pulled up and is standing stiffly at attention. Can you see him over there?
Yes, while Fandango, oblivious, I'm afraid, to everything but the race, ploughs on, standing on his seat and driving skillfully with his foot, it looks like, from here. Of course, Paraguay is a republic. We don't expect them to... Anyway, I won't get into that. Yes, here's the Duke, smiling as always. He must have broken the record for the course, unofficially, of course. He couldn't break it officially. He was never entered, and it wouldn't be becoming. But, as I said before, on another occasion, anything he does well.
Yes. Oh, well, I think that was certainly a great round, a great lap there.
And the Duke's waving. The race is on again. Well, for the students of history and decorum, that was certainly the high spot of the race.
Well, let's go over to the Italian pit. There's only one Italian car still running, and Signor Fanfani seems to be in a kind of thunderous mood. He's walking up and down. Signor Fanfani, what happened to Fandango at the beginning?
I told them to lighten the car to the maximum, and they took out the gas. You can't trust anybody today. It's ridiculous. Don't talk to me about this. It's making me so mad that I probably complain to the organization. Hey, Fandango, he's not driving the last car. He's coming in on the next lap. Allora, una, due, ragazzi, ma no, già ho veduto, una, madonna, camminare, una, due, vede, vai, ma che, va arrabbiato, un fiorio, zitto, va a fare da guarire qua, cosa?
Oh, well, what was that about? You didn't open the... there seemed nothing wrong with his car. You didn't refuel it or change the tires or anything.
No, it's human nature. Fandango, we had an argument before because of the gas situation. And while driving, he thought of an insult and he stopped to tell it me. Pazienza.
Well, there's lap 18 just come up, and there's no car in sight at the moment, so perhaps we'll go over to Roland Thaxter. You've got the roving mic. Where are you now, Roland? Come in, please.
Well, I'm down there to the wildfowl pit, and the wildfowl has just coasted in. A very silent car. I didn't hear it coming at all, and suddenly it was there. And the crew are working with exemplary precision. Of course, this isn't surprising, since they are all... old sweats from Indianapolis, and let's just listen to them. I'll put the mic there.
All right, let's go. Hey, I got news for you. It's time for the coffee break.
You want to make something of it?
If you got complaints, call local 119. I don't want to know.
Jerk.
Okay, take her away, Bill.
Well, I timed that pit stop at 24.5 seconds, which is remarkably fast, and I'll just try to find out from Cy Bellingshausen, the foreman, what they actually did. They seem very busy. Their talk is languorous, but they move like cats. I mean, they're extremely light on their feet and very fast. Cy, would you tell us what you did actually during that remarkably fast visit to the pits?
Well, there was smoke from the dash. We noticed that last time he came around, see, and he had a short somewhere there. And so we signaled him in, and the cigar lighter was permanently lit. Now, that's a fire risk in anyone's language. So we brought him in, we took out the lighter, and we gave him a box of matches.
I see. Well, that was very, very fast, and I do want to congratulate you on it. It is significant, because it does mean that very soon America will be a real threat.
Oh, we've noticed that the blue French cars haven't been in the race for some time. They've done about a lap each, and now we're on the 23rd lap, I think. And let's go in and see what Mr. Orgini is doing. I can see both cars in the pits there. Monsieur Orgini?
Oui.
Both cars are in the pits at the moment.
Yes, they lasted one lap, which surpassed our expectations.
Well, what's wrong with them?
Oh, you know, it's not what's wrong, but how many things are wrong. The plugs are wet, and the wet cylinder linings are dry. That's two things which we also ran out of brake fluid, but Madeleine... Madeleine, viens dire bonjour.
Bonjour, monsieur.
Madeleine brought some honey in town, and it because we ran out of brake fluid. And it has the effect of disc brakes. It's very effective, except that it's difficult to take the brake off. But already there is another complication. I should know better than that, because we are being followed by many wasps.
Now, essayez encore une fois.
Oh, je ne peux pas, vous savez.
Oh, voilà, quelque chose.
Oh, mais non, vous savez, il faut essayer quelque chose d'autre. Well, we will have the last result. Madeleine, cognac.
Oui, VSOP ou Napoléon?
Oh, quoi, Napoléon, c'est patriotique, quoi.
Merde. Well, we are back in the race. What's that delicious smell? I've never known a car smell like that. Oh, it's a crepe Suzette. Well, now, during the 24th lap, I've just taken a little time out, and I'm down in the Fanfani pit, and the Commendatore Fanfani is walking up and down. He's a very unapproachable man. I'm not saying this in any derogatory sense. He's got a lot on his mind. I'll try and talk with him. Commendatore? Have you got a moment?
I have all the time in the world since I'm retiring from racing.
Oh, I hope that's not an irrevocable decision. That's awful bad news.
No, I'm disgusted because when arrived at the the Duke of Edinburgh, the Prince of Edinburgh, was told the beginning, they must all the car must stop, the driver must stand up in the seat, and the Snoceres take advantage of this. I don't consider it a fair race at the moment because they did not rise in the seat.
Well, they said they were going to have great difficulty in rising, if you remember.
I don't care what they say.
And anyway, your car didn't stop at all.
Well, he's got no brakes. What do you expect? You expect me to... I can't do the impossible. I can't stop it by hand if we go on. But at least the pilot stood in the seat. He made the drive very difficult, but he stood. He showed a little loyalty, a little... with a guest here at the gym. They just stopped the car. Yeah, but they don't stop.
What about these brakes? You've had quite a lot of trouble with the brakes today.
Anyone can make a car go slow. It take a genius to make it go fast. Don't bother me with a brake now.
Well, two of your cars have retired owing to back axle trouble, isn't that right?
Well, I instruct my driver to lean forward when he drives. If they don't do as I say, it's not my fault. It's a weakness of a character. Don't bother me with the detail. If you want the detail, then my secretary, I thought you were a conversation at a different level.
Well, by now, please, please, don't take offense, Commander Torre. You...
Giovanni, arrivi la segnale, Corella. I am going to bring Fandango in.
Why? He's going pretty well.
That's my business. Che riata la vera la significazione di questa gente non posso. Era? E con crottozzo della varia della varà. Ah, varare!
Mannaggia l'amore.
You remember before he insulted me? I thought of an answer, I brought him in. I feel better. I have decided not to retire from racing.
Now, Roland, you've been working on the overall picture, haven't you? We've completed 47 laps here, and could you tell us the position so that we can understand who's in the lead? Because it's a little difficult.
Yes, well, at the moment, 47 laps. Von Grips is in the lead at an average speed of 16.33 miles an hour, which has incidentally beaten the Prince of Hesse plus Hesse's 1906 record by 0.23 of a mile per hour, which is indicative, I think, of the enormous strides which have been made in this half decade of motoring and motoring sport. Fandango is breathing down Von Grips's neck, coin a phrase. He's 6 seconds behind him. Foss, driving very steadily on the green pinfall, is some 12 seconds behind Fandango. Dill on the wildfowl is on lap 15, driving a beautifully judged race. And Da Costa Vamos on the Orgini is now valiantly pushing his car on lap 3, having lost the chassis down in the water where the body has been shedding blue paint every time it passed. It only passed twice, of course, but the blue paint stayed there quite a long time every time because it wasn't going very well. And the sea in that little cove really takes on a most luscious colour, as in fact you see on the travel advertisements. Now, among the retirements, apart from the 23 I've mentioned, Fling on the Schnorchedes number 8 was lost at sea. He is a very strong swimmer, luckily, and is quite well, but he has a very bad cold. Fandango's original Fanfani, you will remember, stalled on the starting grid. Fanfani later took over Spike Borkorn's car and had an argument with the gasworks, though there'll be no street lighting in Jib tonight. And the governor, with great resource, I think, which has marked his whole career, has decreed an air raid practice for 8 o'clock sharp. Fandango then took over from Barrel Shibley, the Alaskan, and went into the S's very fast, hitting Da Costa Vamos and pushing the Orgini into its third lap, which is a piece of unconscious generosity, I suppose, but losing power in the shape of its engine in the process. Later, Fandango took over from Jean de Mal, the young Walloon ace, and this car is the one that is still running. Young Toby Cooks, on the spare pinfall, entered a crate, thinking it was the stockpile tunnel, and was loaded onto a Liberian steamer before his protests became audible over the noise of the crane. And the Liberian captain has now claimed the pinfall as flotsam and jetsam, and I do think this must be one of the, the most unusual ways for a car to end a race. Now here they come again, Von Grips, very distinctive in the rusty silver of his car, and Fandango should be by any moment. Oh, he's losing a little tire. Yeah, not sounding terribly healthy. And, here's Foss.
Well, now, just over halfway through the race here. Oh, here's Mr. Volikov. How are you enjoying yourself, sir?
Well, I'm most interested in the overhead
camshafts.
Overhead helicopters, most interesting where the land is. I also like very much the signals.
Oh, the signals to the drivers, yes, they're very colorful.
Signals to the pilots on the radar is very... The bore is interesting, also the bore. or the bore and stroke of the engines, the bore of the atomic cannons hidden in the rock is very, very interesting technically. Also, the base, the wheel base, the naval base is most interesting to observe.
Well, all in all, you like the race?
Yes, it keeps the sentries occupied.
Now, I think we'll go over to the German pit. There seems to be some activity there. Herr Altbauer. Herr Altbauer.
Good gracious, here we whisper during the race. There must not be raised the voice. Well, I'm sorry, I just saw you standing out there and I wanted to know, is anything untoward happening? That's nothing to do with you. We have our own system. Please keep your voice down and there's some eau de cologne to put on the soles of your feet. Shoes, doesn't matter, we must have everything spotless. No, how's your car doing? Well, we knew that we would have a slow start because naturally our drivers are conditioned to the cars, not to the Le Mans start, which was an unfair advantage they took on us. But we knew that on lap 73 we should be in the lead, but now we are lap 72 and Von Grips has taken 0.6 of a second more on the last lap than I had said he must. What was that? Does that mean there's something wrong with the engine? No, I'm going to wave him in. He must blow his nose. Here comes, yep. Musik, andere Musik, schnell. Schnelle Musik, Wagner. Und am schnellen Naseblasen.
Jawohl.
Weg!
And throughout all this, one man has been going ahead very steadily, Gerling Foss. And we're here in the British pit. And Gerling's just floated in, drifted in. How's the race going, Gerling?
Well, the old genie's been shedding oil on the road, of course, making driving a bit dodgy. I wish he'd lost the oil in the water, because it's coming up quite rough now, and the Germans are so low, you see, they get under the waves. They've got a great deal of submarine experience, of course, behind them, and I suppose it's helped. But I've got to time that water splash very carefully now, especially as there's a couple of fishing boats sheltering there, you know. The weather's coming up very nasty, and you've somehow got to get in between them. Have you seen anything on your last lap? Yes, well, I bet Altbauer's hopping mad, you know, since von Grips got involved in the nets down there. He got just a little bit too close to one of the fishing boats, and he's down there now. And, of course, in that position he's in, it's very difficult for him to do anything about it. He can't move. The fishermen are helping, and that automatically disqualifies him anyway, because he must not accept help of that kind. Fandango's in trouble, too.
Oh, really? We didn't know that.
Yes, down in the S's, he took the escape road and crossed the Spanish frontier. Of course, he hasn't got a passport on him. They want to travel as light as possible, and those, I can tell you from experience, those boys can be nasty. If you haven't got your passport, well, it may be 2 or 3 days before he's free.
How's our own Bill Dill? He hasn't come round again. We've been waiting for him.
Well, Bill Dill did very well, but he's stripped a gear in the tunnel, and as he's only got one gear, I'm afraid he's out.
Well, now, Gerling, let's talk about you. You're very modest.
Well, we're British, you know. We don't much like to talk about ourselves. I'll talk about anybody else.
But you're the only one, you must be the only one left in the race.
Well, you know, that's the luck of the game. Do you know my mechanic, Alf Martin? Here he comes. What's that smell, Alf?
Oh, sorry, Gerling, we've got a lobster in the air scoop. It's broiled by now. It's delicious. But the car's pranged, I'm afraid.
Well, can we get it ready in time for Monza?
Well, the lobster's ready now.
Well, with Gerling Foss out of the race, the last element of excitement has drained away and a strange stillness has settled over the course as the restless crowd begins slowly to disperse, unwilling to believe that there is to be no result. The only smiling faces are those of the bookmakers who will be leaving for Tangier on the next boat. Well, the spirit of 1906 still evidently pervades this hardest of all Grand Prix. Will any combination of car and driver be able to break the jinx next year and finish? Who can tell what still lies wrapped in the unfathomable womb of time? Men and automobiles are transitory. Only the rock, gaunt sentinel guarding the secrets of bygone ages, as I find I said before, will bear its silent testimony before history and know forever what no man knows today. This has been Barrett Sparks and
Roland Thaxter
reporting on the second Grand Prix du Rock. Reproduction of all or part of this commentary is expressly forbidden.